Let's thank this great choir that just came and sang up here for us. They did a great job. Yes. Hey, how many of you have been to a Harvest Crusade before? Raise up your hand. You've been to one before, okay. How many of you have never been to a Harvest Crusade before? Raise up your hand. Oh, wow. Well, we're especially glad that you're here. This is our 34th year of doing Harvest Crusades here in Southern California. This is our first year at the Honda Center. We've done 121 crusades all around the world, and we've had the opportunity to bring the gospel in person to 6 million people. And best of all, we've seen 600,000 people make a profession of faith to follow Jesus Christ. Isn't that great? So tonight, this is a very special night. This is not like any other Harvest Crusade you've ever been to before. As you can see, for starters, we're in the round, right? So we've got a screen for every one of you. So really, there's not a bad seat in this house. And you're going to have what I like to describe as an immersive worship experience. And we have some amazing artists to lead us, of course. Our good friend Phil Wickham is with us again. Yes. And for the first time ever at a Harvest Crusade, we have TAYA with us as well. And yes, TAYA is going to sing Oceans. I know you want to hear her sing that. After I speak tonight, we're also going to have music from Passion. It's sort of an after concert. It's going to be great. You're going to be really glad you came tonight. You know, before I was a Christian, I was really searching for meaning and purpose in my life. My mother was a raging alcoholic. Maybe you saw the story. How many of you have seen the Jesus Revolution film? Yeah, well. So you know my story. So I was searching. I saw the alcoholic haze of my mother's bad choices, and I knew I didn't want to live that life. But then I made some bad choices myself. I got into drugs. And it wasn't long until I had concluded, I'm only 17 at this point, but I concluded, I don't want the life of my mother's generation. I don't want the life I've been living. It was sort of like a process of elimination. I knew what I didn't want to do, but what did I want? Why was I on this earth? Why did I exist? And I was going to a school, Harbor High School in Newport Beach. I transferred over there, and four people from Harbor High just clapped back there. And so when I transferred on this campus, one of my druggy friends, because I was using drugs then, said, Greg, really be careful. There's a lot of Jesus freaks on this campus. There's Jesus freaks everywhere. And I said, the last thing you will ever see is Greg Laurie become a Jesus freak. Famous last words, right? But here's what happened. I was walking across my high school campus, and I saw a group of Christians sitting in a circle singing songs to Jesus. They were simple songs, maybe like four chords in the song. But there was something there that I thought, that's real. I want what they have. I never thought of knowing God in a personal way. And it opened my heart up. And tonight, for you that are a visitor, especially if you're not a believer yet, I'm especially glad you're here. In many ways, this night is here for you, okay? You are our special guest of honor, and I'm hoping what you will experience is something similar to what I experienced many years ago, that you will sense God's presence in this place, because Jesus said, when two or more are gathered together in my name, I'm there in the midst of them. Jesus Christ is in the Honda Center tonight. He's here. Jesus Christ is going to change lives tonight. Listen to me. Jesus Christ is going to change your life tonight if you will open your heart. So what I'd like to do is have a word of prayer, and then we'll continue our worship. Let's all pray. Father, we're glad to be here tonight. And now I pray for every person who has joined us and those who are watching and listening all around the world, really, that they will hear your voice. And I pray that many will come to put their faith in Jesus tonight. We pray that you'll be honored in this time of worship that we have, that you'll be glorified. And we just commit it all to you now. Lord, you rule over this place. We declare your name as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we are here to honor and glorify your name. So we commit this night to you. Bless Phil, bless Taya, bless Passion. Bless the message as it goes out. We thank you for this time together in your name. We commit this evening to you now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship together.
Thanks, Pastor Greg. Aren't you guys so thankful for Pastor Greg Laurie? Aren't you so thankful? And I'm also thankful and honored to invite this next leader up on the stage. What a beautiful vision for tonight to gather us together in worship and praise of the one who saved us. I can't think of anyone I'd rather share the stage with and be led by. She has been all over the world and led nations into worship through her songs, and we're so honored to have her here. Would you all give it up for TAYA, everybody? Come on. Sing from a place of victory in Jesus today. The cross is finished. The grave. grave is conquered, and today we sit in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He is with us, he is for us, and because of that, in any situation, you know what we can say, church? When I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. The battle belongs to him today. Come on, let's do it. lift it up a few more times. Let our voices fill up this place. For those of you who are finding yourself in a joyful, pleasant season, maybe you could sing a little louder, preaching over those around you who find themselves in the battle. This side of the room, preaching to that side. This side of the room, preaching to that side. Not just us on stage. One family, one heart, one voice, believing in the God who moves mountains. Come on. So when I fight, so when I fight, I fight on. Every fear and every fear, I sing through the night. Oh God, if I don't be no one more time, sing it. So when I fly, I fly on my knees. With my hands lifted high, oh God, if I don't be lost to you. And every fear.
Prayer of a 4th and 5th century evangelist. And what is remarkable about his life is that this is a prayer that's been prayed for over 1,000 years. But when he was 12 or 13, he was actually stolen from his home country of Wales and taken to Ireland and sold into slavery. He was able to escape and he later went back to his home country of Wales, and there he met the love of Jesus. And his whole life changed. Amen. Amen. And he started rising up to the ranks of his denomination. And they wanted to make him a bishop. And he said, please don't do that. Because I have it in my heart that I need to go back to the very country that sold me into slavery. Because I want to share the love of Jesus with them. And that's amazing. But I feel quite challenged by that. Because I don't know if I would have the same heart under that same persecution. And as it was a pagan nation at the time, when he would share the love of Jesus from township to township, he would pray this prayer of protection. Christ is a light, illumine and guide me. Christ is a shield, overshadow me. Christ beside me, on my left and my right. This day be within and without me, lowly and meek yet all powerful, lowly and meek yet all powerful. Christ is a light, Christ is a shield. My friend and I were moved by that. And we put it to a little melody, but the whole prayer of even bringing it tonight is that you would realize that Jesus Christ is all around you. He's all about you. And he is to your left, and he is to your right. And he goes before you, and he hems you in behind with his presence. And he's here right now. May we have eyes to see you, Jesus. May we have ears to hear your call tonight, Lord Jesus. May we respond to your gospel and your goodness tonight, Lord Jesus. You are here, Lord Jesus. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. Amen. Christ, as in light, illuminate, guide me. Christ, as a shield. Overshadow me, Christ, under me, Christ, over me, Christ, beside me, on my left and my right. Stay be within and without me. Christ as a light, Christ as a shield, Christ when I'm standing, Christ when I need, Christ here beside me on my left and my right, Christ all around me all my days and my nights, Christ as Christ as a shield, Christ when I'm standing, Christ when I need, Christ here beside me on my left and my right, Christ all around me all my days and my nights. Come on, we sing it out. Christ as a
Christ in the sand, be on my left and right. I know you feel like a face in the crowd tonight. There's a lot of people here. And you just feel like maybe God doesn't even know who you are or where you are. Nothing could be further from the truth. He sees you as an individual. He knows your needs, and he wants to change you tonight. I don't know what your condition is tonight. Maybe your life has fallen apart. Maybe life is going relatively well for you. But still, the issue at hand here is your sin forgiven? Are you certain that if you die tonight, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that you would go to heaven?
Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, rose again 3 days later, and he is alive, and he is here with us right now, speaking to our hearts.
Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock, and if you'll hear my voice and open the door, I will come in.
God has dropped one lifeline from heaven, one way for you to know him, and it's Jesus Christ. There is no life away from him.
Tonight is the night when you can come and be forgiven. Tonight is the night when your life can change. 2,000 years ago, Jesus hung publicly on a cross for you. Will you stand up publicly for him?
Over the last 30 years, we've seen over 600,000 people make professions of faith. It's about people coming to Jesus right here. This is what it's about. The angels are rejoicing.
Amazing. Can you believe the number of people that have made a decision to follow Christ? 600,000 people that have had their lives eternally changed. 6 million people that have been here in attendance at a Harvest Crusade. Absolutely amazing. Multiple continents. We've been in the United States, all over the United States. We've been in Australia. We've been in New Zealand. We've gotten to share this message of the Harvest Crusades and share the message of the gospel through radio, web, TV, all of these things. And we see these great numbers, 6 million people, 600,000. And I just love that God knows the individual. He knows each and every one of our stories. He knows us by name, the Bible tells us. He knows us so intimately that he knows the number of hairs that are on our head. And one thing that blows my mind is that for every sinner that comes to repentance, the angels rejoice in heaven. And I wonder, as I look around the room tonight, how many here may have had their lives changed by the power of the gospel at a Harvest Crusade? If you've had your life changed, would you raise your hand up? You had your life changed by the power of the gospel at the Harvest Crusade. Raise your hand up. Look at these. Hundreds of hands, thousands of hands around this room. Hold them up high where people can see them. That's amazing. This is the power of the gospel. This is what we love to do. And I want to tell you something tonight, that no person, none of those 6 million people, none of those 600,000 people that came down on the field, came down on the ground, asked Christ to come into their lives, not one of them has paid to get into a Harvest Crusade, because we believe in presenting the gospel in a free and approachable way for everybody to hear. And I want to tell you tonight, the reason we are able to do that is because of the generosity of saints in the past and saints today who continue to partner with the Harvest Crusades financially and help us to do what we are able to do. We will always open the Crusades free to anybody who can come, present the gospel to anybody who will listen, as long as we're able. And that's where you come in. Tonight, I want to extend to you an opportunity that you would partner with the Harvest Crusades, as many have in the past, so that we could see future generations come to Christ, the Generation Z, Generation Alpha, the generations to come, even beyond that. We know that God is not done with the United States. We know that the gospel message is going to continue to be preached until the return of Christ, and so we are going to be faithful to our part, and we want to invite you to help us do what God has called us to do and gifted us to do. My dad's going to share a very important message tonight about who Jesus Christ is and how you can have your life changed. And we pray we will see many people come down on the floor tonight to make that decision to follow Christ. And so for all of us here tonight, we have an opportunity to help us offset the cost so we can continue to do these events as long as we're able. And so somewhere around you, as you are here in the event, you should be able to find an envelope in the seat in front of you. If you want to pull out that envelope right now, there's going to be some instructions on it. And if you would like, you can fill some information out on that. And in a moment, our ushers are going to come forward and we're going to receive our evening offering. And you can help us to offset that cost. You can give your generosity, that gift, drop it into the basket, the bucket as it comes by. Or if you're here and you'd like to give digitally, there's information on your screen. You can go to harvest.org/donate, or you can scan that QR code on the screen and you can help us to do it that way as well. Whatever way you choose to give, we just want to tell you, we can't do this without you. This is a church effort, a church with a capital C. This is not just Harvest, our local church. This is the church. We have thousands of volunteers here, hundreds of thousands of volunteer and man hours to put this event on. Many churches coming together to help put this event on. And we couldn't do it without any one of them, but we also need you to help us as well. And so as we receive our evening offering, we're going to pray, and then the band is going to play a song, and we'll have that bucket pass. And so would you pray with me now? Lord, we thank you so much for your faithfulness over the years, Lord, that you have done such a great work here in Southern California, across the United States, across the world, Lord. It's the power of God unto salvation, that gospel message. It has changed lives. It has changed my life. It has changed my family. And Lord, we pray that many lives would be changed tonight because of the gospel. And so, Lord, we invite you to do a work here tonight. And Lord, we invite you to use these offerings to bless your people, to increase the kingdom of heaven. Lord, we commit it to you. They're just tools in our hands, and we want to give it back to you. You have made us to be stewards. You have given us these things, and we want to give it back to you, our Father, because you have blessed us. We love you, and we pray that this time of giving is a blessing to you, a sweet-smelling aroma to you, our Father in heaven. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray, and everybody says, amen. 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 God bless you guys.
Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe there's going to be a day where he wipes away the tears from our eyes, where he makes all things new, and he restores all things. I love singing about the hope of heaven that we have in Jesus. It's like my favorite thing to sing about, you know? I find that the more I think on heaven, you think if you sing about heaven and think about heaven a lot, you get your head lost in the clouds, you know? But it's kind of the opposite. Very much so for me. The more I think about what Jesus did for me, to forgive me and set me free, to put this hope of heaven inside of my heart that's never going to leave, man, it makes me want to live for heaven today. Amen? And so for the next couple songs, we're going to sing, but this song is called Hymn of Heaven. And if you are a citizen of heaven with me, if you want to be, let's make this our anthem in this moment. Thank you, Jesus, that in you, always at the end in you is life. Always at the end in you is healing, is resurrection, is restoration, is glory. We think that you have already won. We sing it. We're going to worship you. How I long.
How I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets. To look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity.
Come on.
There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer desperation, the songs of faith we sing through doubt and fear. In the end, we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. Amen, amen. With one voice, a thousand generations will sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Let's join them. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. We'll be right back.
Jesus.
This is who he is. He loves, yeah. And this is our God. He saves us. He bore the cross, beat the grave. So let heaven and earth proclaim, this is our God, King Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phil Wickham and TAYA. Fantastic. Fantastic job. Wow. Oh, tomorrow night's going to be great, too. Chris Tomlin is going to be here with us. I think of Chris as America's worship leader. Also, the Harvest Worship Band is going to be here with some brand new music. And also, Michael W. Smith will be with us as well. It's going to be an amazing evening. Let's pray for a moment. Now, Lord, quiet our hearts as we think about the most important issues of life. This life, the meaning of it, the afterlife, where we will spend it. Speak to us now, we pray, from Scripture, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The title of my message is Jesus in You. You know, we have a big crowd here tonight. Thousands more are watching, literally all around the world. But when God looks at a crowd, He sees an individual. Jesus sees you. Jesus cares about you. You know, it's a funny thing. People are so enamored with superheroes. Did you know over $3 billion of our hard-earned money has been spent on superhero movies from all the studios out there? And here's the thing. I hate to break this to you. These superheroes, they're not real. That was kind of a Joe Biden moment there. They're not real. I know Aquaman can breathe underwater and Wonder Woman has superhuman strength and the Wolverine can heal rapidly from injury, though he's a manicurist's worst nightmare. Imagine giving a mani and a pedi to Wolverine. The Hulk, he has superhuman power. You just have to get him mad and super green. But they're fictional. They're not real. But there was a man who walked on our planet who had unlimited power. He didn't breathe underwater, he walked on the water. And his name was Jesus Christ, and he is the King of Kings, and he's the Lord of Lords, and he's in this place right now. He's here with us. You know, God can seem so unapproachable. He's so powerful. He's so mysterious. But Jesus was God walking among us. I heard a story about a little boy who was scared one night, and he called up from his bedroom to his father, "Daddy, Daddy, I'm scared." The father said, "Son, you're okay. God is with you." And then the little boy said, "But Daddy, right now I need someone with skin on." Jesus was God with skin on. Jesus was not just a good man. Jesus was the God-man. Jesus was God spelling himself out in a language we could understand. God had come near. God had a face. You know, we like to celebrate certain people. If you're a powerful person on social media, you have millions of followers. The guest of honor at a celebration that's called the Man or Woman of the Year. Time magazine every year picks the person of the year, and every 10 years they pick the person of the decade. But there's only one person that literally divides human history in half, and that's Jesus Christ. There's never been anyone like him, and we're fascinated by him. 77% of American teenagers, according to one survey, said, want to know more about Jesus. 3/4 of millennials say they're searching for a purpose in life. Listen, you've come to the right place because I want to talk to you tonight about Jesus and you. And I want to start with this. I know you've heard it before, but I got to say it, people. God loves you. Jesus Christ loves you. He really does. You say, "Oh, but Greg, he doesn't know me." Oh, actually, he knows you very well. Jesus knows you better than you know yourself. He knows every detail about your life. And did you know that not only does he love you, but he has a special, unique plan for your life? God is not mad at you. God is mad about you. And here's what God says. And one of my favorite verses, Jeremiah 29:11. God says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Now, if God had simply said, I know this singular thought I once had about you for a fleeting moment, I'd be happy with that. But he says, I know the thoughts, plural, more than one, that I think towards you. And then we think, yeah, but what kind of thoughts are they? They're good thoughts. God says, thoughts of peace and not of evil. He loves you. He has a plan for your life. And listen to this. God's plan for you is better than your plan for yourself. It really is. It really is. I heard about a little boy and his father who went into a hardware store. And as they were checking out, there was a big jar full of candy. And the hardware store owner said to the little boy, son, grab a handful of candy. It's free. The little boy didn't grab it. He just kind of looked up at his dad. Hardware store owner again said, son, get a handful of that candy. It's free. Still, the boy wouldn't take it. He just looked up at his dad. Finally, his dad reached in, grabbed a handful of candy, and he got in the car with his little boy. And he said, son, why didn't you grab the free candy? And the little boy said, because, Dad, your hand is bigger than mine. God's plan for you is bigger than your plan for yourself. It's really amazing. And he loves you and has a purpose for you. And I want to look at a story in the Bible about a woman who was down and out, a woman who messed her life up, a woman who was living immorally and got caught in the act of sin, got caught in the act of adultery. Now, in case you don't know what adultery is, that is sex outside of marriage. The only place that God will bless sex is in a marriage relationship, you see. So that's sexual sin. And I heard about a little boy that was in Sunday school, and the teacher talked about adultery. And as he was driving home, he said to his mom, Mom, the teacher said we should not commit adultery. What does that even mean? And the mother said, that means you should not plow another man's field. Okay, just leave it at that. She didn't know what to say, right? But this woman was caught in the act. But look at what Jesus did for her. I'm reading from John chapter 8. As Jesus was speaking, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees brought a woman who'd been caught in the act of adultery. They put her in front of the crowd. Teacher, they said to Jesus, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says she should be stoned to death. What do you say? They were trying to trap him, saying something they could use against him. Listen to this. Jesus stooped down and wrote in the dust with his finger. They were demanding an answer. He stood up again and said, all right, let the one that is among you who has never sinned cast the first stone. Then he stooped down again and he wrote in the dust. And when the accusers saw this, they left from the oldest to the youngest. And then there was left just that woman and Jesus. And Jesus turns to her and says, woman, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? She said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. Isn't that a great story? Love that story. So this woman's caught having sex. A bunch of religious dudes known as the scribes and Pharisees catch her in the act. Who knows? Maybe they even set her up. And it was really a trap for Jesus. And she's thrown on the ground in front of him. And Jesus starts writing in the sand. What do you think he wrote? Tic-tac-toe, your move. Maybe a little cartoon? I don't think so. We don't know what he wrote, but maybe he wrote, you shall not commit adultery, and then wrote someone's name next to it, like Caleb, then looked over at Caleb. And then maybe wrote another commandment, looked over at that other guy. Hey, Josh, you broke that one, didn't you? And they left. I gotta go. I have a roast in the oven. Let's go. They left from the oldest to the youngest, and all that's left is just this woman and Jesus. And he looks at her and he said, where did all of your accusers go? Now, it's interesting because we read Jesus looked at her, and the word look means he looked right through her. Have you ever had anyone look right through you? Let me restate the question. Do you have a mother? Maybe you're up past curfew. Mom says, where have you been? Nowhere, Mom. Look at me. Look at me. And then you start confessing things you didn't even do, right? But Jesus looked through her, but it was not a look of anger. It was a look of love. And here's a really amazing thing. He says, woman, where are your accusers? And the word he uses for woman is a term of respect. In fact, it's the same word he used to describe his own mother as he was hanging on the cross. When looking down, he saw her there. He said, woman, behold your son. It's like saying to a woman, lady or ma'am. It's a term of respect. Now listen, this girl had been called a lot of things in life, but she had never been addressed this way. But this is why Jesus called her that. He didn't see her for what she was. He saw her for what she could become. You see? You know, you see a failure. God sees your potential. You see the past. He sees the future. And then these words, go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. Now you think, wait, when did this woman become a believer? I think in the moment he dismissed her accusers, she said, I believe in Jesus. You know how long it takes to become a Christian? Not very long. Sometimes people say, you know, I'm in the process of converting to Christianity. It doesn't take long. It doesn't take a year. It doesn't take a month. It doesn't take a week. It doesn't take a day. It doesn't even take an hour. It can happen just like that. In a flash, in a moment, you can go from non-belief to belief. You really can. I think it's happened for some of you already. You're thinking, preacher, get done with your stinking sermon so I can become a Christian, right? Because it's a move of God's Spirit on your heart. And maybe that's already happened for you. And Jesus says, go and sin no more. It's implicit in this statement where he's really saying, don't keep living in this lifestyle. Okay, I'm forgiving you, but don't live this way anymore. Listen, God loves you just as you are, but he doesn't want to leave you this way. He wants to change you. He really does. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is an altogether different kind of person. Old things have passed away. Behold, everything becomes fresh and new. Right? I love it when it rains because everyone gets a free car wash. And the birds come out and maybe you'll see a beautiful rainbow. And that's what happens when you become a Christian. It's like you go from black and white to color. You go from death to life, and in your future, you go from hell to heaven. That's what it means to be a Christian. You say, but Greg, I'm really messed up. I've done a lot of horrible things. You can put your past behind you tonight and become a new person if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, because he died on the cross for all of your sins, and he rose again from the dead. And he's here right now standing at the door of your life, and he is knocking, and he's saying, if you'll hear his voice and open the door, he'll come in. So I want to talk to you about one other guy before I close. So we talked about this immoral woman. Now let's talk about this religious man. He's identified as the rich young ruler. We don't know a lot about him except that he climbed his little corporate ladder very quickly. He was very successful. Came up to Jesus and said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Probably had a tricked out BMW chariot, custom wheels lowered, holding a latte, a lavender latte. Well, what is the lavender? Where did this lavender come from? Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus said, well, you know the commandments. Don't steal, don't kill. Don't commit adultery. Oh, yes, the guy says, I've done these ever since I've been a little kid. Jesus said, have you? Well, I'll tell you what, buddy. Why don't you take all of your stuff, get rid of it, give it away, and come and follow me, and you'll have eternal life. Isn't that interesting? Jesus never said that to anybody else. Because Jesus could see that in this guy's life, his stuff was more important to him than God. Listen, everybody worships something. Some people worship things. Some people worship relationships. Some people worship a career. And some people worship God. And I wonder, who is your God tonight? You have a God. And there might be something that's keeping you away from Jesus. And I'm telling you right now, whatever you give up to follow Jesus will be more than made up to you. To someone struggling with drugs, Jesus might say, take your drugs and flush them down the toilet and follow me. Well, could I sell them? No, that's called drug dealing. No, get rid of them. I'm struggling with alcohol. Yeah, pour it down the toilet too. Put it all in the toilet. Make sure you flush it. Someone might be in a relationship right that's pulling them away from God. A girl, a guy. They don't want you to follow Jesus Christ. Maybe Jesus would say, you know what? You're going to have to break off that relationship and follow me. I wonder if there's someone listening to me right now that would say, I would really like to follow Jesus, but I wonder what the person sitting next to me would think if I did that. The person sitting next to you is thinking, I would really like to follow Jesus, but what would happen to the person next to me if I did? Who cares? Really, who cares? One day you'll stand before God all by yourself. And this man was wealthy. We think wealth is going to solve all of our problems. He found wealth early in life as well. We all watch this tragic story of the Titan submersible, where these people got in this tiny little miniature submarine to go 2 miles plus down to view the wreckage of Titanic. And we all know that on their way down, they had what was described as a catastrophic implosion. This thing was the size of a minivan. Using a video controller, a video game controller, to guide it. And you think, why would a person get into that thing? Among the people that were in there, a couple of billionaires. One was a British billionaire, age 58, who made his private fortune selling personal jets. He holds 3 Guinness World Records for past extreme trips. Why would you do this? And a well-known psychologist whose clients include some of the world's wealthiest people said, like any other drug, sensation-seeking creates a tolerance level in the brain. We need to feel more. You might start off making $1 million, but then you need 2 million, and then you take more risks, end quote. You know, people say, if I just get in this rocket ship and go into space, it may cost me $500,000. I want to do that. Or I'll go to the depths of the sea. Yeah, I want to do that. That's not where the answer is. Listen, the psalmist says, if I climb to the sky, you're there. If I go to the depths of the ocean, you're there. You'll be there waiting for me. What you're looking for is Jesus Christ. He's right here. He's right here, right now. We have never had more distractions in our world than we have today. And most of them have one of these in our pocket, the cell phone. I read a headline the other day, screens are zapping the life out of teens. It's the new Great Depression since the rise of social media. One article says, depression and feelings of hopelessness have skyrocketed among teens. Nearly half of tweens and teenagers say they agree with these phrases. I do not enjoy life. And my life is not useful. That's nearly twice as many as said that same thing a decade ago. Teen depression and suicide are on the rise. Suicide is now the second leading cause of death among young Americans. Listen, the answer is not in tech. The answer is not in money. The answer is not in fame or more followers on social media. The answer is in a relationship with God through Jesus Christ. That's what you need. I'd add one other thing about this rich young ruler. He was religious. And religion can keep you from Jesus. Let me say something that might surprise you. I think it's possible that when it's all said and done, religion may keep more people away from God than all of the other sins and vices put together. It's true. Because, you know, when you're doing certain things, you know, maybe it's a sin, maybe you don't, but you know, you're living a life you're not proud of. But when you're religious, you're so, hey, man, I don't need that. I'm a religious person. You might be saying, but Greg, aren't you religious? I hope not. I don't want to be religious because I think religious people are just flat out weird. I really do. I don't think religion made them weird. I think they were weird to start with, then they just got religious, that's all. They're just weird people, and the problem is weird people never know they're weird, but they are. I am not interested in being a religious person. I'm not talking to you tonight about religion. I'm talking to you tonight about a relationship with Jesus Christ. But you know, a religious person, they'll say, well, I go to church, so I'm good. Well, do you really go to church? I'm a CEO Christian. What's a CEO Christian? Christmas and Easter only. But I'm not so sure about Christmas this year. Maybe just Easter. We'll see. There's people like that. But religion can keep you from God because you're self-righteous. You need to realize you're a sinner that needs a Savior. Years ago, I was with my son Jonathan. He came up a little bit earlier. And he was a little guy, and I was taking him out surfing. And so I'm kind of keeping him above the water, helping him to catch waves. And all of a sudden, I got caught in a riptide, okay? But here's the problem. I'm only a few feet from the shore, but somehow I'm in this riptide. I'm getting pulled out, and I'm holding him aloft, trying to keep his head above water. And I'm thinking, this is ridiculous. I'm so close to the shore. I can't call up for help. And there's a lifeguard looking at me. I thought, I'm holding him up. I'm starting to take in some water. And then she comes down from the lifeguard stand and she's running toward me. I'm like, oh no, no, I don't want to be saved. I am okay. And she starts swimming toward me and I'm thinking, oh no. And then suddenly I got my footing. I said, I'm okay. She waved. I said, thank you. But that's how we can be. I don't want to be saved. I don't need to be saved. Hey, I was caught in a stinking riptide. Bottom line, I needed some help. You're caught in something worse than a riptide. You're caught in sin, and there's only one person who can save you, and that's Jesus Christ. He's the only one. Clean living won't get you to heaven because you're not clean enough. Good works won't get you to heaven because you've not done enough. Only Jesus Christ can give you that hope and that change and that purpose you've been looking for. So let me close. What do you need to do to come into this relationship with God? Number one, you have to admit you're a sinner. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Every one of us have broken God's commandments. Every one of us have fallen short of God's standards. Not one of us have kept those commandments. The word sin in the Bible means to not only cross a line, but it means to fall short of a goal. We do both. We're all sinners. But the good news is the Bible says, why were we yet sinners? Christ died for us. So I have to realize I'm a sinner. Number two, I need to recognize Christ died on the cross for me. See, that was his plan from the very beginning. Nails did not hold Jesus to that cross 2,000 years ago. Love did. Love for you. Love for me. Jesus said, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. As I said earlier, God loves you. He died there for you. If you had been the only person on planet Earth, Jesus would have gone to the cross and suffered and died for you. And no, he did suffer. He loves you so much it hurts. They drove spikes through his hands and his feet. They tore his back open with a Roman whip. They put a crown of thorns upon his head, and he bled and suffered and died for the sin of all the world. But he bled and suffered and died for your sin because he loves you. I love the way the Apostle Paul put it when he said, he loved me and he gave himself for me. Jesus loves you and gave himself for you. Then you must repent of your sin. The Bible says God has commanded people everywhere to repent. The word repent means to change your direction. It's a military term. It means like an about face, right? So instead of running away from God, you run toward God. You turn from that sin. You're sorry for that sin. And you change. And then you must receive Christ into your life. Jesus must come and be your Savior and your Lord, and only you can ask him to come in. I can't do that for you. Your parents can't do that for you. Your friends that may have brought you here tonight can't do that for you. You have to say, Jesus, I need you. Come into my life. Be my Savior. Be my Lord. And he'll do that for you. And then you must do it publicly. And in a moment, I'm going to ask you to do what over 600,000 people have done over the years of our Harvest Crusades. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to get up out of your seat and come down on the floor all around this stage and make your public stand for Jesus Christ. Hey, Greg, why are you at the Honda Center this year and not Angel Stadium? People have asked me. Well, because Angel Stadium didn't want us to walk on the field this year. It said, you can have your event, but you can't have people walk on the field because of the baseball games, etc. I said, well, then we're going somewhere else because we like to call people down to make that public stand to follow Christ. Maybe they'll change their mind and we'll go back there someday, but I'm good for now. So you can make that public stand to follow Christ. Jesus said, if you will acknowledge me before people, I will acknowledge you before the Father and the angels in heaven. But then he said, if you deny me before people, I'll deny you before the Father and the angels. So I'm going to ask you to make a public stand in just a few moments. And lastly, you must do it now. You must do it now. Because the Bible says today is the day of salvation. You might say, well, Greg, I'll come back tomorrow night. Well, you can. Get here early. We had to turn some people away tonight so you get a seat. And I hope you will come back. But listen, don't wait till tomorrow night. Do it right now. There's not a better moment to give your life to Jesus than right here, right now, wherever you are. And you won't regret it. I remember so clearly the day I gave my life to the Lord over 50 years ago. And as I prayed the prayer asking Jesus to come into my life, I thought to myself, this isn't going to work for me. Because I'm not the religious type. I was very cynical. But I'm so glad to say God isn't looking for the religious type. He's looking for the sinner type. And that means you and I qualify, right? And I prayed that prayer, and something happened to me. Jesus came into my life, and something's going to happen for you. You say, well, Greg, I'll clean my life up and come to Christ. No, don't clean your life up. Come to Christ, and he'll clean your life up. You just come as you are tonight. You come as you are. So we're going to pray, and then I'm going to invite you to come down on this floor all around this stage and make your public stand to follow Jesus Christ. And when you all get here, I'll lead you in a prayer. You may never have another opportunity like this tonight. Let's pray now. Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit will convict and convince every person here, every person watching, every person listening of their need for Jesus, and help them to come to you and believe. We commit them to you now, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen. Do you want your sin forgiven? Do you want to know that when you die, you will go to heaven? Do you want to find the purpose and meaning of your life? Are you ready to say yes to Jesus Christ? If so, I want you to get up out of your seat, make your way into the nearest aisle, and come down here on the floor and make your public stand to follow Christ. Come on down now. You come down. If you're on the top level, it's going to take you a little bit longer. So you in the top level, you make your way down. We'll wait till you all get here. You're not too young to come to Christ. You're not too old to come to Christ. You're not too good to come to Christ. You're not too bad to come to Christ. You come. Listen for a moment. Shh. Let's not talk. Let's not talk. Let's pray. Let's pray for these that are making the most important decision of their entire life. Pray for the person in front of you. They may be grappling with this decision. Pray for the person behind you. Pray for the person on your right and your left as they make this decision to follow Jesus. Listen, to not say yes to Jesus is to say no. Jesus said, you're for me or against me. You're with me or you're opposed to me. This is a yes or no proposition. You get up and come wherever you are, and we'll wait till you all get down here. Let's be praying as people make this commitment to follow Christ. You get up and come now as Phil Wickham leads us in a song. Jesus told a story to show us what God is like. We sometimes call it the parable of the prodigal son. It's a story of a man who had two sons. One of the sons said, loose paraphrase, Dad, I'm sick of your rules and regulations. I'm going to go live my life. And I want my portion of the inheritance that's coming to me. So he took that money and went to a distant place and blew all his money on sinful things. And one day that boy came to his senses and he thought, this is insane. I need to just go back to my father and say, Father, I'm sorry, I've sinned. I'm not even worthy to be called your son anymore. And he began to make the journey home. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, the dad missed his son. He looked down that long road every day in hope for the return of his son. And one day, he saw a familiar silhouette coming his direction. And he squinted and said, that's my son. He got up from his chair and began to run toward his son. And the boy probably thought, Dad's so ticked off at me, he can't wait to beat me. But the father ran to the son and threw his arms around him and said, let's rejoice. This my son who was dead is alive again. He who was lost is found. And they had a party.
That's how God feels toward you. You know who told us that story? Jesus. Jesus told us that story to show us what God is like. He longs for our return. Maybe there's somebody here tonight that walked with the Lord as a young boy or a young girl. You had a relationship with Him, but you've drifted away. You've sort of pushed God out of your life. Maybe you're facing the consequences of that bad decision. But the Father's calling you home again tonight. It's time to come home. It's time to return to God. And He welcomes you with open arms. You just must come. You just come. So I'm going to ask you to come now and make your way down. Make your public stand for Jesus Christ. And when you all get down here, I'll pray with you as Phil sings.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven, and I spoke Your name into the night. Then through the darkness Your love and kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, and Jesus Christ, my living hope. Sing hallelujah.
Now you that have come forward, I know some of you are in the aisle and you can't get down. Sorry about that. But all you, listen, you don't need to be on the floor to come to Jesus. He's here right now, wherever you are. Okay. And we are going to give Bibles to every one of you that we can. And if perchance you aren't able to get on the floor and get a Bible, we'll make sure we give you one on the way out. So be looking for it, because I'm going to give you a Bible that looks like this one I'm holding right now. It's called the New Believer's Bible, custom designed for someone like yourself putting their faith in Christ. Very friendly translation. We want you to take one home. But here's what I want to do. I want to pray. So I want every one of you on the floor to pray, every one of you in the aisle to pray. If you're still in your seat, you pray this prayer. God will hear you. The Bible says whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. So you pray this prayer out loud after me. This is where you are asking Christ to come into your life. Mean it from your heart. God will hear you. Let's all bow our heads and pray. Pray this out loud after me. Lord Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner, but I know that You're the Savior
who died on the cross for my sin and rose again from the dead. I'm sorry for my sin. I repent of my sin. I choose to follow Jesus from this night forward. Thank you for hearing this prayer and answering this prayer. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Okay, so listen. You that have come forward tonight, there's someone standing near you with a sticker that looks like the one I'm holding here. See that green sticker? That says decision follow-up. So make sure you meet one of these people. They want to talk with you. And we have a QR code you can scan where we will send this Bible and other materials to you. So if you look up on the screen, hopefully that QR code is up there for you as well to scan, and we'll send you these materials. But listen, there's four things you need to do as a Christian. Four things. Number one, read your Bible. That's why we want to give you a Bible. Read your Bible. The Bible is the Word of God. God will speak to you through the Bible each and every day. Number two, pray. Prayer is just talking to God. It's listening to God. It's bringing your problems to God, your needs to God, asking for wisdom from God. The Bible says, pray without stopping. It's a beautiful communication you have with the Lord now. So you pray. Number three, go to church. Go to church tomorrow. Go to church. Right. So we'll tell you about churches that you can go to in your area. Go to church, because at church, that's where we grow together spiritually. And we need church. And the church needs you. And then lastly, tell somebody about Jesus. Tell someone about what Jesus has done for you. And come back tomorrow night with someone that does not yet know the Lord for the final night of the Harvest Crusade here at the Honda Center. Okay, so listen. You that are on the floor, I'm used to saying the field. You that are on the floor, find one of those counselors wearing that sticker. And counselors, start making your way to people right now. And don't leave without getting your own copy of this New Believer's Bible that looks like the one I'm holding. So my son Jonathan's going to come and give you some direction. And then in just a few moments, we're going to have another after concert by Passion. So don't
Thank
leave.
Thank you for joining us for this live Harvest Crusades. If you just prayed with Pastor Greg, we want to say welcome to the family of God. And we want to hear from you.
You know, you can reach out to us by requesting a Bible. That's one of your first steps in your new relationship with Christ. Free of charge, we'd love to send you one to help you get started in your walk with the Lord. You just go to harvest.org/Bible. Again, that's harvest.org/Bible. There are so many people right now who are making a decision to follow Christ for the first time, and some even recommitting their lives to Christ. And maybe that's you today. Maybe you're watching and you feel stirred and you want to accept Christ or recommit your life to Christ. You know what? You can do that from wherever you are. There's a button there on the screen that you can click on. We would love to send you a Bible, and you too can pray with Pastor Greg to accept Christ into your life.
And this is a holy moment right now, and you are a part of it. And so if you want to say that prayer right now with Pastor Greg, we're going to get back to the stage in just a second, and you can make that prayer. And then afterwards, like Tiffany said, you can click that link, and we will send you a Bible right now.
Copy of the New Believer's Bible. I'm also going to ask that everybody in the room, as we're counseling those on the floor, if everybody could just listen for a moment, if we could bring our conversation to more of a hushed tone as those that are being counseled on the floor. So if we could just speak a little more quietly. Shh. This is a holy moment that's taking place down on the floor here tonight in the Honda Center. People have made a decision to follow Christ. It's an amazing thing. So let's try and speak in quieter voices so that those that are being counseled can be heard. Thank you. If you are down on the floor and you have not yet received your copy of the New Believer's Bible, please hold your hand up and a counselor will make their way over to you. Hold your hand up and a counselor will bring you that Bible.
chains break at the door. I need a shelter, people of God. Now you call me a citizen of heaven.
make us strong. Good for us to be here, to be in the presence of a move of God in California. This is beautiful. Has God done something in your life tonight? Has God spoken something into your life tonight? So many beautiful songs already have been sung in the room. So much truth has been spoken. God is doing something miraculous and supernatural in the room tonight. We want to give Him praise for that. We want to give Him thanks and praise and worship for that tonight. So this song is a chance for all of us who have tasted and seen the goodness of God. Maybe tonight, maybe in your lifetime, you've tasted and seen, you know that God is good. He's opened your eyes to see the cross. And this song is just a way for us to say, God, for all that you've done and for all that you're doing, we say, we praise you, we worship you, we love you. Jesus, come into full view now. Come into full view. Lord, we ask for a spirit of wisdom and revelation in the room tonight. As we sing the truth and the power of the cross, we continue to open eyes to see. Please. Oh, sing hallelujah to the King.
you have any doubt why you have come tonight, I hope you know by now that it was to encounter the name above every name, the name that at every knee will bow and every tongue confess that He is Lord, and that name is Jesus. That's what all this is about. We've said it time and time again, but I don't think we can say it enough. Because every one of us who stand up here have encountered Him, and He's changed us. He's changed our lives, and that's why we're here, because we know that He can change yours too. So we're going to sing a new song, and I love it. It uses this word witness, and it's not really a word that we use a lot these days, but I love how Eugene Peterson puts it. He says, a witness is someone who is not at the center, but points to what is at the center. And if that's not what we are to do as children of God, as believers who have seen Jesus, to point to Jesus, who is the center of all things, then I don't know what we're here for. And we've all seen His goodness, His faithfulness, and this song just simply says we can count on seeing it again and again and again. And because we've seen it, we want to tell everyone the good news that we've heard, because it's just that, it's good news. So I'll teach you the chorus, and then we'll worship Jesus together. It goes like this. I witnessed your faithfulness. I've seen you breathe life in. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're your promises never fail. I've got stories I live to tell. So I'll pour out my praise again. You're worthy, God, you're worthy of all of it. Yes, Jesus, you are worthy.
Praise. You're strong and I've witnessed it. You're constant, I've witnessed it. And I believe that I see it again and again. You love and I've witnessed it. It's who he is. You heal and I've witnessed it. It's what he does. You save and I've witnessed it. And I'm confident I see it again.
Come on, you don't need us to sing this. You can sing directly to our Savior. You are worthy. Lift your voice and sing His name. You are worthy. Go from
Harvest Anaheim. Let's thank Passion one more time for leading us tonight. Come on, this is amazing. Praise be to Jesus. Well, hey, we want to let you know that the weekend's not over yet. Tomorrow night, we have another great lineup. We've got an amazing message from my dad, Pastor Greg Laurie, telling people how they can have their lives changed by the gospel. We saw hundreds, if not thousands of people down here making a decision to follow Christ. Absolutely the highlight of the night, no question. Tomorrow night, we're going to hear a message from him. We're going to be also hearing music from our good friend Michael W. Smith is going to be in the house Sunday night. We've got music from Chris Tomlin as well, leading us. Amazing. And then we also have our very own Harvest Worship that's going to be leading us with some very new songs they're going to be releasing. Make sure you come back tomorrow night and bring a friend. We also want to tell you that as you leave this evening, we have merch booths available to get some really great t-shirts and hats and hoodies and sweatshirts and all kinds of fun stuff. Make sure you check those out on your way out. That helps us to offset our costs. And every t-shirt that you buy pays for 5 Bibles. That's right. So if you buy a t-shirt, that pays for 5 Bibles that we gave away down on the floor here tonight at this event. And so make sure you grab some stuff, get some fun merch. We also want to let you know that July 8th, we are going to be having a very special baptism. We're going to be doing it at Pirates Cove at 8 a.m. So if you want to come and join us for this historic baptism down at Pirates Cove, which was featured in the movie Jesus Revolution. Come and join us next Saturday, 1 week from today, at 8 a.m. at Pirates Cove. We'll be going for a while. It's going to be a blast. If you got saved here tonight, man, what a great way to come and share with everybody about your newfound faith than being baptized in the ocean there with us, July 8th at Pirates Cove. And lastly, if you made a decision to follow Christ tonight and you did not get your copy of the New Believer's Bible, make sure you scan that QR code up on the screen right now. We'll throw that up there. You can be on the lookout as well for our follow-up teams as you leave, and you can get your Bible there. But with that, I'd like to close our night out in prayer. And so would you join me as we just commit the rest of this evening to our God? Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for the work that you did here tonight. The unity that we sense, Lord, is found nowhere else. This is the unity, this is the peace that people are looking for across the face of the earth, and we know it is found nowhere else than in a relationship with you. Lord, you tell us that it is by the love we have for one another that we will be known as your disciples. It's by our love. And so, Lord, we pray that you would increase our love, you would increase our potential for making friends and connecting with people in the body and inviting people to come into this relationship with you, Lord. Use us, we pray. We are so thankful to be your children. We're so thankful for what you did here tonight, and it's to you that goes all the glory. So we bless your name, our Father in heaven. It's in Jesus' name we pray together, and everybody says, amen, amen. God bless you guys. We'll see you tomorrow night. Thanks for joining us. Drive safe.